request you to kindly fill up the feedback form after the end of the conclave and hand it over to the MMA officials. All right, ladies and gentlemen, the stage is set and the dignitaries have arrived. A very, very, very warm welcome to the dignitaries, invitees, members of Madras Management Association, and also the other association members who are part of this conclave today. A very warm welcome to this prestigious national conclave on the theme, Growing Family-Owned Businesses in India, organized by Madras Management Association, in association with Conrad Adenauer Stiftung and with the support of Great Lakes Institute of Management Chennai, and also as a knowledge partner, and also with Agra Trading, Ascent Foundation, Fiki Flow, and Tamil Nadu Chamber of Commerce as event partners. We are also very proud to share with you, ladies and gentlemen, as MMA has got 9 chapters in Tamil Nadu, and also for the benefit of our worldwide audience, this conclave has been webcast live. In fact, all major MMA conclave seminars and conventions are webcast live to our audience. A very warm welcome to our viewers who are watching this live webcast. Ladies and gentlemen, I now invite the dignitaries to take their place on the dais. Please welcome them with a round of applause. Mr. L. Ramkumar, President, Madras Management Association and Chairman, Shanti Gears Limited. Dr. K.C. John, Distinguished Professor of Strategy and Family Entrepreneurship, Great Lakes Institute of Management. Mr. K. Srinivasan, Managing Director, Carborundum Universal Limited. Mr. C. K. Ranganathan, Chairman and Managing Director, Kevin Care Private Limited. And Group Captain R. Vijay Kumar, VSM, Executive Director, Madras Management Association. As MMA tradition goes, we always commence the major events with an invocation song. I now request Ms. Padmaja to come onto the stage to render the invocation song on Lord Narayana. I request the audience to kindly rise for the invocation song. Thank you.
Hari Hari Narayana, Hari Govinda Narayana, Hari Hari Narayana, Hari Govinda Narayana, Hari Gopala Narayana, Hari Hari Narayana, Rishikesha Narayana, Partisha Narayana, Hari Hari Narayana, Hari Govinda Narayana, Hari Gopala Narayana, Hari Hari Narayana, Hari Hari Narayana, Hari Hari Narayana.
Thank you, Padmaja. May I request Mr. C.K. Ranganathan to kindly present a floral bouquet to Ms. Padmaja. Thank you, sir. Mr. L. Ramkumar is the President of Madras Management Association and Chairman, Shanti Gears Limited. I now invite Mr. Ramkumar to deliver the welcome address and introduction.
Distinguished members, on the dais, esteemed guests, invitees, delegates from corporates and small and medium enterprises, my fellow managing committee members, past presidents, one of them I understand now is on the dais itself, Mr. CKR, our partners in this, Great Lakes, very important, and Agra Trade, FICCI, FLO, ASIN Foundation, ladies and gentlemen, very good morning to all of you. It gives me great pleasure to welcome you to this very unique conclave. I don't know when was the last such conclave held in this part of the country. This has been done in collaboration with Great Lakes, designed to see that we cover all aspects of the family-owned businesses. It's very well known across the world, businesses started with families, and many families with their enterprise and innovation have contributed to the development of business and industry. And it's a very significant thing in India, because in terms of numbers, India is the third largest in terms of the number of family-owned companies after China and USA. The market cap of all these companies together is something like $839 billion. They had a study which said amongst the top 30 companies in Asia in terms of value, India had more than 50% of the numbers. So that speaks the importance of family-owned companies in India. And we also know the big names in India, be it Reliance Industries or then big groups like TVS or Murugappa or Birlas and everybody, they're all controlled and owned by family. And of course, we have one very shining example of Mr. CKR himself, whom I'm sure we'll talk about how he looks at this in terms of going towards the future. When we talk about family-owned organizations, of course, right from the Kirana store next door, you know, where we live in the neighborhood, they're also family-owned companies. But this conclave, I'm sure, is going to be more about little medium to big, large-sized companies which are going through this phase. Now, what is the critical thing in family-owned companies? I was thinking, because having spent bulk of my own career in family-owned enterprises, I thought the trick is to get the balance between ownership and management. Because business objectives are not clear, not different, whatever may be the structure you follow. It may be family-owned, it may be government. I'm talking about commercial organizations. I'm not talking about non-profit organizations. Commercial organizations, the objectives are very clear. If I have to make it very simple, it is value creation and long-term sustainability. If you take care of value creation for all the stakeholders, it's not only to the shareholders, but only if you create value to the employees and the consumers, you'll also create value to the shareholders. So if you are able to get the balance in terms of ownership and management, I think you are through in this. This is very easier said. I think historically, if you see, it all starts with one or two people having bright ideas. They have an idea, they start the business, it becomes successful. But as you scale up, it is impossible for the people to manage everything. So I think as you are a startup or a very small company, the ownership and management is not diverse. As you become bigger, it's very essential because of geographies, because of the scale, it's impossible for a couple of people or two, three people to decide everything that's happening in the company. So the delegation starts, I suppose it starts with the operations management. But over a period of time, companies grow larger, the markets are becoming very dynamic, the family becomes larger, and there are many stakeholders within the family. So I think that gives whole lot of complex issues that need to be sorted out. But I think the best companies have, in India itself, looked at how to do this and have come out very successfully. I'm sure we're going to have some of those practices going to be spoken about today in this conclave from various speakers. But I think what is happening is the demarcation between ownership and management is also smudging, in the sense, typically when you say owner, you think it's a shareholder or a person who has all the who has put in all the capital. And when you say management, it's all professionals or employees. But I think today, the owners are taking the role of more of enterprise and entrepreneurship, and they need to drive performance. And managers are also taking ownership. It's not only in terms of getting some stock options or something like that. The best of companies create leaders who take ownership for the business as if it is their own business. That's a style which many successful companies have followed. But at the same time, there are changing generations in families, there are dynamics of business, aspirations, the purpose of the business, everything needs to be aligned as you take the entire family together. And then there are capital needs and other things which are going to be covered in this particular conclave today. So I'm sure you're all going to have a very interesting day as we go forward. Now coming to the speakers, CKR, a very successful entrepreneur and who has actually created quite a bit of discontinuity in the FMCG space, where he is up against the MNCs. And I think he's quietly going about it in a way that they come out with so many new innovations and new products. And he's also created a fantastic organization where a lot of young people aspire to join and learn. I think that is a real test of saying whether the company is most admired or not. And more than anything else, what we admire here from MMA is his passion for identifying, rewarding, and nurturing entrepreneurship and innovation. We got an annual feature, which is an important event in the calendar of MMA and the company of Kevin Care, where we have the Chinnikrishnan Innovation Award. Those of you who have not attended it, I very strongly recommend that you should attend this, where people from this part of the country, they may not be the well-known people. They are, most of them are young, aspiring, and have breakthrough ideas. They are being identified. They are being recognized. On top of it, CKR himself personally takes interest in nurturing them and scaling up in terms of making them big. So CKR, we're really thankful to you for taking time off to be here. And being present here, it makes a big difference in terms of what we're going to speak here. Then I come to Mr. K. Srinivasan. I'm used to calling him, it's only KS. Very rarely we say K. Srinivasan, who is the managing director of Carborundum, a longtime colleague for me at the Murugappa Group, a veteran of the Murugappa Group, known for his no-nonsense, on-the-face, matter-of-fact speaking. I'm sure he's going to give us a lot of insights into how he looked at. You know, he has a ringside view of what goes on in the Murugappa Group for having been there for so many years. And there are very tricky issues where I'm sure he would have had a role to play in terms of giving his bit on how we should take it forward in the interest of the organization. So we would get to know from him what you may call a professional's view of how family-owned businesses are being run and what should be done in future for the growth and development of these kind of companies. Then we come to John, one of the karta of this program. And he's shown a lot of enthusiasm. As you know, he's specializing in this. There are a lot of schools in the US, as you know, who have only main courses on family business management. And he's chairing this thing in Great Lakes. He's given us a lot of input. I think they're also going to have a one-day convention, etc., in Great Lakes University. My welcome is not complete unless I talk about our ever-energetic group captain, who has put in a lot of effort. If I saw the calendar of last 1 month, this is one of the events. You know, it's a 24/7. Yesterday, day before, all the days, we had some fantastic programs. I think personally, he and his secretariat have brought in a lot of input into what goes on into this, and also getting all the other organizations, like-minded organizations, will be interested in this program. Now, finally, coming to Madras Management Association, I don't want to do a big sales talk. Most of you seem to know, but those of you who are coming here for the first time, we have around 7,000 plus members from various categories, corporates, MSMEs, professionals, consultants, etc. We conduct around 600 odd programs. Now these programs are to suit the various types of members we have. We have some big events, signature events like the Students Convention, Annual Convention, Women's Managers Convention, etc. But we also have very specified programs such as today, which is very focused and going in depth into certain things which are of contemporary interest to everybody. Apart from that, we have a number of certification programs and knowledge giving programs which are for the middle to junior level management, where they are benefited by people who come from the industry to teach them as to what they should be doing in the job. So once again, a very, very warm welcome to all of you. And I'm sure you're going to enjoy the deliberations of today, and the net result is it would set us thinking about what other approaches we could follow to face some of the issues we have been facing day in and day out. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Casey John is currently the Associate Professor of Technology, Innovation and Entrepreneurship and the Director of Center of Excellence for Technopreneurship with Great Lakes Institute of Management. He also mentors a group of first-generation entrepreneurs, and he's also a fellow with the Indian Institute of Management, Ahmedabad. I now invite Dr. Casey John to present the overview of the conclave.
Good morning. Distinguished panelists on the dais, Mr. C.K. Ranganathan, Mr. K. Srinivasan, Mr. Ram Kumar, and Group Captain Vijay Kumar. Distinguished delegates to the Family Business Conclave, members of the press and media, ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Bala Balachandran, founding Dean of Great Lakes Institute of Management, Chennai, who is also a member of the management committee at Madras Management Association, sends his heartfelt greetings to all of you. Yeah, he could not be here. He is in Illinois today. It's always a pleasure to collaborate with Madras Management Association and Mr. Ram Kumar and Group Captain Vijay Kumar. My collaboration has been under different incarnation. Under this incarnation, it is for the first time we are working together. Family Business is a constituent member of the 7,000 and odd members of Madras Management Association. Plus, it's a very vital and vibrant group here in Madras. And it's very appropriate that Madras Management Association and Great Lakes Institute of Management together bring this Family Business Conclave. We wish to look at some of the challenges which family businesses are confronting today and how some solutions could be evolved through the deliberations today. Great Lakes Institute of Management, as you know, on its pilgrimage from good to great, has decided to address the strategic needs of the family business in two forms and factors at its 15th year of existence. It's starting a global MBA on family business management. It's meant for all the inheritors, as Mr. Ram Kumar was talking about. All family business inheritors, they need to be groomed, they need to be prepared, and that's the program which we want to start. And we are collaborating with Babson College, which is number one in the world on entrepreneurship and family entrepreneurship, and we together offer this program. The second one, which is much more germane to Madras Management Association, is that we have set up a center for family enterprise leadership, where we want to look at challenges, opportunities, and how we could make family businesses contribute to the growth of the country. And that's what we are going to study. And it would be great to work closely with many of you to take care of that. Undoubtedly, as Mr. Ram Kumar was saying, that business schools and scholars have very recently got interested in the family businesses. But the family businesses have been there for millennia. And I always say that we are one of the late entrants, yeah? Perhaps the earliest versions are of political and military dynasties that conquered and ruled territories all over the place. Examples of epic poems, our own Mahabharata, compilation of tales such as 1001 Night, and many plays of Shakespeare talks about the family business. Family businesses have been the subject of fictional treatments too. Novels including, many of you would have read Cousin Betty, Middlemarch, and War and Peace. They also render and shape thoughts and help form stereotypes of the interactions among family businesses. In the mid-20th century, historians published numerous books about family involvement in business, and they looked at and reinforced and contradicted many of the stereotypes of family businesses, and it includes, among others, the Birlas, the Cadburys, the Slims, the Waltons, the Murugappas. Murugappas is into the sixth generation right now, yeah? So many of these have been documented, and they talk about both stereotypes and contradictions. But it's useful to distinguish for the family business conclave that 21st century in India, family businesses are not uniform. They are very heterogeneous. And Mr. Ramkumar referred to the heterogeneity which comes. And let me talk about four or five of them. Corporate governance creates variability in family business. Ownership concentration creates differences in family businesses. Founder versus multiple generation. We were talking to CKR before we got in, and he said that he's the first generation, and he decides what his dad didn't do, he will do it in a meritocratic-driven organization in the first generation. Whereas Mr. KS represents a multi-generational family business where they have consciously decided that professionalization is the way to go. They have created family business council, they have created management council, and then they have left professionals to run the business. You know, so there is huge variations in terms of founders and multi-generational involvement. There is differences in resources. Resource configurations in family businesses which are of nascent origin would be different than the multi-generational businesses, and it creates variability. Family dynamics and how relationship between family makes the decision making tough or easier, that creates variability. Yeah. So business scholars and business schools look at family businesses through myriad collection of conceptual lenses to understand what family business is all about. In the context of the family business conclave today, we have reframed the opportunity which we want to address here. All of you have read the deceleration in the country which we are experiencing for the last two quarters, yeah? And when we talk to CKR, he says that that's an opportunity for us to grow. So that's how family businesses looks at. For professionals, it may look at as a challenge, but for family businesses, this provides opportunity to find out ways to innovate in terms of growing the business, yeah? Now, what's also very true is that we are going to hit the $5 trillion economy by 2025. That's how we would be joining the super rich, super powerful club. And what we want to look at is how we could address the challenges and opportunities confronting the family-owned businesses and steer our discussions towards how could family-owned and family-controlled enterprises could make major contribution to the growth of their businesses. It's as we said, that for millennia, family businesses have been there. They have been contributing, and we are moving away from the socialistic pattern of growth to private sector-driven growth, and it's very important for us to figure out what family businesses could do. And the way we are curating the entire discussion today is under three special sessions. We would look at session one, shift in the mindset of family-owned enterprises to look at challenges as an opportunity and be much more innovative. Innovative in terms of offering product, services, innovation in terms of business model, which we could scale. That's what we would look at. The second session would be on financing India's nascent family enterprises. Their sets of opportunities and challenges are very different from the multi-generational large family businesses. And as Mr. Ramkumar said, that if you look at Asian family businesses, 50% of top 30 are in India, and their opportunities are very different than larger section of the family businesses. And we want to look at the entire challenges of nascent family businesses. And last but not the least, we want to look at how do we ensure family legacy through multiple family offices. Family offices are becoming very critical. They are helping very family-owned businesses, and we want to address how we could create that opportunity. We have curated these discussions, and we will end with a panel discussion on winning strategies for family businesses. So what we have done is to assemble eminent thought leaders and practitioners from family businesses around these three sessions. They would tell us more about how they see the opportunity and challenges, and subsequently we would figure out during our deliberations today, what's the way ahead for us as a family business? We, the MMA and the Great Lakes will strive to make family businesses much more vibrant, and we are hopeful that we would make this conclave an annual session every year so that we could address challenges which are emerging every year and how we could address. We look forward to your contributions. We look forward to your significant participation during this day, and hopefully we should go wiser at the evening and we would go back to our businesses much more energized, much more excited to do things which we have not done so far. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. John. Mr. K. Srinivasan is the Managing Director of Carborundum Universal Limited, CUMI as it is popularly known, a 2,400 crore company with 28 manufacturing sites in 7 countries. Since taking over as a managing director in 2005, Mr. Srinivasan has grown CUMI from a leading Indian abrasive company to a global player with major operations in Russia, China, South Africa, Australia, and Thailand. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Srinivasan as I now invite him to present the keynote address.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. Mr. C.K. Ranganathan, Mr. Ramkumar, Group Captain, and of course, Professor John. It's a great pleasure to be on a panel with such eminent speakers. I have been invited here to share my experience of being a part of the Murugappa Group. So let me start by bringing greetings from the Murugappa Group and our chairman, Mr. M.M. Murugappan. The Murugappa Group, as some of you may know, was the first Asian business that was awarded the IMD Lawson Award for Outstanding Family Managed Business in 2001. So when I speak about my experience about working in a family business, I expect that in sharing this, there is some learning for some of those people who are still running family businesses. Family businesses, like all of them mentioned, has been there for many, many years. Most economic activity in developing countries starts largely through family organizations and eventually blossoms into larger corporates. As the countries develop, they have less of family businesses as the corporates become much larger. So if you look at it, developing world has something like about 60 to 85% of all its businesses as family businesses. But in America, it would probably be nearer to about 30%. But there are always exceptions. Walmart, one of the largest retailer, is still a family business. So there is no specific rule that as you become bigger, you will not be a family business. So that's the first caveat I take before I start. Family businesses largely have to grapple with the 5 C's. They first need capital, then they need to have control. They have to have a career for all its constituents, the members of the family. They have to learn to manage conflict. And of course, they have to create a culture which will hold them all together. So these are the traditional 5 C's of a family business. And I'm going to share the Murugappa story and to see how these 5 C's played out in its last 100 odd years. In addition to the traditional 5 C, I would add one extra C for developing countries, and that's contacts. You need to have a network, and this helps you, particularly in the early days of building a company. So let's go back to the Murugappa story. More than 100 years back, in the plantations of Burma, the laborers needed to have funds provided to them, so they needed some kind of an indigenous banking. And to provide this indigenous banking, the Chettiars of south of Karaikudi area went there to provide them money. They didn't have capital, so they actually borrowed the money from the Lalas and Sets of Bombay. And they lent this money to the laborers in the plantation. So they actually were playing an arbitrage game. They were borrowing and they were lending, and they were making money in between. The reason why the investors handed out the money to them was they were trustworthy. The reason why the borrowers could borrow from them was, again, they were trustworthy, industrious, hardworking. They were not charging them usurious rates. They were charging them fair rates. They were a family. They would help them during times of distress. And they grew the business this way. And eventually, they built up the first C, capital. And the first C of capital was built basically by being industrious, trustworthy, hardworking, and being a part of the culture in which they worked. They could speak Burmese, they could speak Tamil, they learned all the languages, they spoke English fluently, much better than me probably. And this helped them to network and connect up with the Britishers of those days there. And this helped them in good stead when they had to come back after the communist revolution in Burma made it impossible for people to stay and work there. They lost most of their assets there. And when they came back to India, this network, or the sixth C as they talk of, connect, allowed them to set up manufacturing in India. The first thing they set up was to try and make steel cupboards and steel furniture at a place about 15 kilometers from here at Thiruvathur. They had set up this plant. They had got themselves a shed, and this was really early days, just before the war. It was very difficult to get anything done in India. They brought an old rice barn shed from Burma, set it up, and started making steel cupboards and furniture in the brand name of Ajax. And to finish it, they needed what is called as a sandpaper, something which you need to rub before you paint. And this was not available because war was practically breaking out in Europe, and this was all going into war supplies. They managed to locate an old maker, again using the sixth C of contact, in Midwest of Canada. A maker is where you make those sheets. It's like what you run your cloth through. And they had it boxed, shipped out by steamers, and the technicians were supposed to come here to commission it. The steamer landed, the containers landed, and the technicians didn't. So the next 2 years, they battled around trying to make it work and tried to produce paper-coated abrasives, which is used for sanding. And in the process, they learned to make coated abrasives. And what was Ajax steel cupboard and furniture ended up as Ajax abrasives, which is the precursor to Carborundum Universal as we see today. So this helped them to get into business. And they started using the capital and the contact to build up a small business. They lost part of the capital when they came to India, but the contacts helped them to revive and set up business. Early days, all the members of the family had to work together to put this thing together. So what happened, what started earlier as a first generation of entrepreneurs moved to the next generation as inheritors. Now this is the inheritor. They had already set up the abrasive business and this had to be built and grown. We had independence coming and we had other opportunities. They used their contacts and they started tying up with various British companies, with the Birmingham Steel Company, which is the BSA. They built up various businesses in India. And with this, they created career for the next generation of people. So that's his third C. You create capital, then you build a career for the next generation of people who are really the inheritors. The inheritors were as industrious as the entrepreneurs. They built the business, they worked diligently, they stayed together, and they ensured that business progressed. But as business progressed, it became more complex, it became more difficult to run. So that is where you need to understand the third C of control. They needed to have control over their businesses. They had started most of their businesses in partnerships because that was the need of the day. So you have Tube Investments with TI of UK. They had the Birmingham Small Arms for BSA bicycles, etc. They had Carborundum, which is a tripartite joint venture with Carborundum, Niagara Falls, Universal Grinding Wheel Company, Staffordshire, as well as the Murugappas. Incidentally, they were not known as Murugappas in those days. Each of them called different names. They called them the TI Group. They called them different names at that time. And they used the transition to actually get control. They had built a business, and they gradually bought in into their collaborators. And as the collaborators exited, they bought their shares and established control. They had in most of the businesses by this time between 40 to 50% of their shares. Control not only in terms of share ownership, but also in terms of the way they manage their businesses. So that was the third C, as I would say. The fourth C is most important. Businesses, family businesses, don't last more than three generations, not even 3% last. The reason is the fourth C, which is conflict. If you don't have in place strong conflict resolution systems, you don't have in place effective conflict management, you don't have structures which will prevent major conflict breaking out, conflicts are inherent in family businesses, and that's the first reason why not even 3% of the businesses last for more than three generations. So they had the strong conflict resolution processes in place, and what did they do for this? They first had two levels of management, and I think Ram Kumar did mention about it. They had what is called as the Family Management Council, which really managed the family. In the early days, the first generation when they came here, they could study in PSI school. Some of them couldn't study, but they did go abroad and do some management programs. But in the next generation, they set up strong criteria. They said each youngster must go abroad and study at least for 2 years. Must work in outside companies at least for 2 years, not in the group. Must come and do apprenticeship under a business which is not where his father is working. And he would work with he would be mentored by one of the uncles. So there were strong rules put in place. There were rules that even if a family member of a particular generation get the same salary, he would not have a car better than his boss. If the family could afford, and he could afford to buy himself a good car, but if he's, let's say, going to work under me, and if I'm entitled to use a particular car, he must not and cannot have a car better than mine. So there were strong rules and regulations. He must be seen as a part of the organization structure. And so these all ensured that conflicts were managed well in time. The family council meets once a month, and the family council has all the family members as members, and that's male family members. That's another thing probably that will change over a period of time. And I'm sorry, that's what it is. I see a lot of ladies shaking their heads. Okay. So, but that's where it is, and I'll come and see how they manage that part of it as well. So the family members would all meet in this council, and the leader of and the council would deliberate on the various issues. And the Kata, who is the senior-most male family member, would take the final decision. And his word is final. Irrespective of what it is, that's final. And when he says, that's it, and that's it. So it ends there. The business, like Ram mentioned, was separated from management. The management was run by professionals. A professional can also be a family member if he had come through the business. He would also not be, let's say, barred from running businesses if he has come through the business. And they would run the business as professionally as anybody else. So ownership and management was fairly diverse. So they were diverse from each other. So we call ourselves a family-promoted, family-guided, professionally managed company. So conflict was largely avoided by this, and conflicts were quickly resolved. Many of the family members, if they do not make the cut and do not have the interest to be in the family business, they would still get the same compensation as through the family office as what a cousin of his or a person in the same bracket would get, but he need not be working in the business. So it was not mandatory that every family member must be in the business. Now coming to the ladies of the family. So what they normally did is the ladies of the family were in charge of looking at all the CSR activities. The family as early as 1922 had started some level of formal CSR activity, and this was formalized by AMM Trust and MCRC as early as 1954. So it's been around for more than 68 years. And all these trusts, schools, colleges, educational institutions are all managed by the ladies of the family. My chairman's mother, she's 84, and she has been running the Vellayam Chettiar School in North Madras. This school takes in about 5,000 students, and exactly half of them are girl child and half of them are male child. More than 70% are first generation learners. This is in the fishermen area. More than 70% are first generation. You must imagine what a first generation learner is. They come from families where have been hugely protein deficient. Even if they make all their effort and learn, they'll forget things as quickly as they learn. So So it's an amazingly difficult kind of background from which you take students and educate them. She's been managing it for 40 years. Their success rate is more than 99%. So that's a far, far more difficult business to run. It's not a business. It's a socially relevant cause. And they spend all their time running the non-business part of the Murugappa group. And so that's important as well. Now, coming back to conflicts. So the conflicts were managed very effectively. The last C, as we talk, is culture. Eventually, what makes the Murugappa group big is not the 16 family members of the Murugappa family who are in business. It's how to get the 30,000 odd employees of the Murugappa group to feel that they're part of the Murugappa family. That's getting the family to become bigger, and that's where you build culture. Now, culture is built by very many things, and I'll give an example of some of them and how they do this. We have what is called the five lights, the guiding principle on which the group is run. It's respect, responsibility, quality, integrity, and passion. These are the five lights, five guiding principles around which the whole business is run. Now, the family has to exemplify in every one of their actions how they stand by these five lights. And that's how you build culture. Like you know, there are events. Events move to processes. Processes move to habits. Habits move to culture. It almost takes you 30, 40 years to build a culture. And the group has been so much at it to build a culture that we say this is the Murugappa way of doing things. And that's what builds the larger family of 30-odd thousand people. So I'll give you a couple of examples. When Mr. M.V. Subbaiah, a chairman at that time, retired, and there are other rules, this probably is good to mention. Even if it's a family member, he retires at 65. He may be, however good it is, he retires. And at 65, he retires, he'll go back and do work for the socially relevant causes. Maybe he'll be in the foundation, he may be in the trust and other things, but he will retire from running commercial businesses. So Mr. Subbaiah retired at 65, and at that time, they did not have an immediate family member to take over as a group executive chairman. So they brought in an outside person by the name Mr. P.S. Pai. Mr. Pai at that time was the president of Wipro, and he was brought in as a group chairman. And the stalwarts who had to report to him were Mr. Alagappan, Mr. Velayan, Mr. Murugappan. They were all family members. And once they decide to bring an outside chairman, they subject themselves to the same discipline of having to report to this chairman. And Mr. Subbaiah, the retiring chairman, wanted to show an example that he says when he hands over, he really hands over. So he said, I'm not going to be in Chennai because people informally, formally will start coming back and referring or checking with me. So at 65, he decided to go to Kellogg's and do a family business conclave. And he actually studied for 2 years there at Kellogg's on the family business management and said, I'm not going to be here. And when we hand over to an external chairman, whoever, he would be the chairman. And that's it. And that's a discipline you subject yourself to. That shows respect. That shows responsibility. That's how you build culture. I'll give you a couple of other examples. One of our earlier chairmen, some of you may have known him, Mr. M.V. Arunachalam. Outstanding gentleman. And I remember once we were in one of our guest houses in Delhi. It was really one of those cold Delhi winter, not the warm Delhi of today. And we had we were having dinner and evening, couple of youngsters from TI came to the guest house. They were from Chennai. They were woefully, inadequately dressed for a Delhi winter. And they came in shivering into the guest house. They had no booking. We were having dinner, and he said, come, sit down, have dinner. And then they quickly realized very sheepishly that there was no booking there, and the guest house didn't have rooms. In those days, we didn't have all these telephones and emails, so you had to send faxes and probably didn't come through or whatever. And then very politely, he said, okay, Srini, now let's go. We go out and stay in a hotel so these guys can stay in the guest house. So let's go out from here. Now, what did he do by that? He sent a message that there is respect, there is a responsibility. You must look after your colleagues. There are many, many such things which demonstrate a commitment to quality, commitment to integrity. And integrity is not just in terms of being honest. It's much more than that. Integrity to what you think, what you direct, and what you do. One other example worth mentioning in this would be the famous saying of Mr. M.V. Arunachalam, one of our chairmen of many years. He used to say in the bicycle business in those days, and Ram was running bicycle business for many years, and bicycle business always is very difficult. In those days, we had license. You could produce only that many bicycles. If you didn't, if you wanted to produce more, you had to go to Delhi to get a license, and we wouldn't go there because we have one of the lights, file lights as integrity, and license are not given. So we had only that much, and we would produce that many bicycles. And when you produce less bicycles, you don't make money. So one of our suppliers in those days used to be Munjal's, the Heroes group of today, and they used to make parts for our bicycles. And these bicycles would be made, and the famous saying of Mr. Arunachalam always used to be, we will build bicycles for profit if we can, but for loss if we must. But we will always build outstanding bicycles. And we have stayed true to that because we couldn't get more license. We couldn't make money. Probably he had a prophecy that we will never make money in bicycles, Ram. So he mentioned that if you have to make for losses, we will, but we continue to make only good bicycles. So the commitment to quality, the commitment to integrity was always demonstrated by action. And that's what ensured that the group built a culture. And that is what ensured that the group could stand up and say, look, when we say this, we do this. And so those were the five C's, as I say, which built a family business. Our business has been around for more than 100 years. As with everything, the fourth generation has moved. Now we have the fifth generation coming in. So in family business, we always say first is a set of entrepreneurs who start the business. Then it moves to the inheritors who inherit the business, who try and develop it and make it better. And then it moves to what I call as trustees. They have inherited a business which they have to control, guide, magnify, and convey it to the next generation. So the third generation onwards, you become trustees. The Murugappa Group has seen a generation of trustees who have run the business. They have the next generation coming in. The challenge is how to keep it going. Like I said, family businesses last, only 3% last for 3-4 generations. We're moving into the fifth generation. We have lasted so far. The culture helps organizations to stay together. And when I talk of culture, and I'll say this last anecdote and I'll close. Family businesses are relevant because they serve a mid-path between, let's say, state-owned enterprises and the more corrosive, cash-only, quarterly result-oriented corporates. They sit in the middle Goldilocks spot where they are midway between the two extremes. They are not laid back. They are not hugely risk-taking. They are ambitious. They are not, regressive. They are not far aggressive, corrosively aggressive. They are ambitious. So they always sit in the middle, the Goldilocks mid-spot, where they're relevant to the communities, they're relevant to the societies they operate in. And when you talk of culture, this is not just India. I'll give you an example of one, and this with it I'll close. We were looking to buy a company in Russia. And Russia, even today, is a very, very interesting country. Things are run differently in those countries as well. So we were trying to buy this company from an oligarch. Oligarch are those big guys who run businesses, and they're always surrounded by people carrying AK-47. So we were negotiating with our chairman and me. We were negotiating. We had sort of more or less done this transaction. And in the last days, we were supposed to meet the two oligarchs. Some of them are in jail, so I can mention their name. So these are the Ananyev brothers. And they were running, at that time, the Promisvyaz Capital Bank and the Promisvyaz Bank and all that stuff. So we're trying to buy this company from them. And he was one of them in the Duma. Duma is the parliament. So the last days discussions are going on. We had more or less agreed, but we were haggling for $3 million in the end. So since morning, the discussions are going and going. There's not even water on the table. Big room, empty, bare table. And teams would come and sit on that side, go away. And then another team will come and go away. We don't know whether we're going forward or backward, and we're discussing. And I was losing patience, and I tell Murugu, let's go. We have had enough of this. These guys don't want to sell. They can keep the company. So let's go. And my chairman is never flustered. He says, Srini, wait. I said, Murugu, just 2 hours for the flight. And Moscow traffic is horrendous. So I said, let's go. He said, no, just get me a piece of paper. So he takes a full sheet of paper and a nice handwriting. He writes a short note to the Ananya brothers and saying that, look, we have done everything. We have come here. What we offer is good for the company, good for its employees, good for you as a seller, good for us as a buyer. It's good for everybody. So I think we should go ahead and do it. I'm sure you would have been busy in the Duma. I was sure this guy was sitting in the next room. He said, I'm sure you'll be busy in the Duma, but as soon as you come back and take a look, give me a call and let's see if we can still do this transaction. So I go there, I give it to his secretary and say, look, we're going. And she said, just give me 5 minutes. I'll just call him up. And then for sure in 10 minutes, the two brothers come and I'm sure these guys are probably in the next room. And then we have a discussion. And the last bit of haggling was, look, we can do the deal. But you must take out this property, which is a nice piece of, it's like a resort, just by the side of the Volga River, where the employees get to go and spend 2 weeks there every year as some kind of a benefit for them. It's got a nice resort kind of a thing. And so he said, you must take this off from the transaction and you should give it to us separately. We don't want to sell this. You take it off from the company and you should give it back to us. And the rest of the deal is done. But if you still want this, you must give us $3 million. So I said, Murugu, this is not a part of our payback calculation, everything. What are we going to do with this real estate? Just give it back and let's go ahead with the transaction. And Chairman says, no, I'll not do this. The employees of this company are used to having the 2 weeks of vacation. That's an entitlement that they're used to. I won't do this deal if you don't buy that. So I said, bro, but this is not going to pay me back. And my payback will go up and I don't want this. He said, no, we will buy it with the property. I don't want a loser in this. So we paid that $3 million and bought it. And the story doesn't end here. I was always saying, why the hell do we spend more money and I have to earn this back damn thing? So the story didn't end there. So a couple of years back, we had the 55th year celebration at the Volsky town. These are the old big town building enterprises. There are more than about 1,800 people working there. So it's a small town, so almost 1,800 families are there into a big town hall. All of them are there to celebrate with us, more than 4,000 people. And MM was speaking there. He was speaking in English. And I believe 99% of the people sitting there didn't understand a word of what he was saying. But they were listening and clapping. They were clapping, clapping, clapping. He had done good for them, and they respected it. And they had seen value. He had demonstrated culture. He had demonstrated that what you do is not good for only the company, but it must be good for the community, for the employees, for everybody. And that's where family businesses can take those calls, which is beyond financials. And that makes a big impact. And that's all about building culture, building long-term value. So ladies and gentlemen, you have a long day ahead. Thank you all for being here. And thanks, Group Captain, for having me here. Have great deliberations. Wish you all well. Good luck and God bless. Thank you all very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Srinivasan, for sharing your thoughts and insights. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. C.K. Ranganathan is the founder chairman of Kevin Care Private Limited. He was conferred the prestigious Entrepreneur of the Year Award by Economic Times in 2004, and very recently is winner of 2018 ICIS World Surfactants Awards for an outstanding contribution to the surfactant industry globally. Please welcome Mr. C.K. Ranganathan.
Mr. Ramkumar, Mr. Srinivasan, Professor John, Group Captain Vijay Kumar, ladies and gentlemen, we are already behind schedule. MMA is known for keeping up the time. I'll try to be as brief as possible. In family business, it's always known there is two kinds of family businesses. Are you a family business or business family? This is the kind of thing is normally asked. So family business is giving importance to family. Of course, family is very important, no doubt on that. Family members will be given all the key questions, all the important thing, irrespective of their competencies. And more belief, it comes from that. I think very naturally, I think as human beings, we believe our own close family members much more and put them in very important positions, finance or any kind of these things. And somewhere what happens is when the organization grows, the individual doesn't grow along with that. It becomes a conflict. And we are not able to deal with that. It will create problem in the family. Therefore, we live with that kind of a pain. And that creates a lot of ruffles as we go forward. And eventually business suffers. And that's why it's called, whether it's a family business, family is priority. Family business means family is priority. When it requires money, anything, it is kind of this thing is taken. Because one core thing when family business, you call them, it operates what is good for the family, then what is good for the business. When you call it business family, business is a temple. And you normally call it, you do any decision is always taken, which is good for the company, not which is good for the family members. The belief is that if something is taken good for the company, eventually family members will be benefited. And that's the whole important thing. And that's true. I think all the time, the conflict comes to, as the business and family grows, which is good for me, or which is good for the family, or which is good for the business. A lot of times, when the deviation happens, I have seen in my own this thing, experience, whenever people take decisions which is in their personal interest, business suffers. I think that's a very, very important thing. All the time, family wins when you take the right decision, which is the most important thing for the business. So I think business starts off, India require more and more family businesses, but the problem and the trouble comes the second generation and third generation when they come. I think very actively the kind of conflicts and the way the families are managing, is the complexities are much more. I will talk about my father's business. My father died of heart attack. He created a business. Then we brothers didn't know the intricacies of the business. My elder brothers jumped into, they started managing and built the business nicely. And I joined after college. I think one of the family rules are all not there. I was taking care of manufacturing, my elder brother was taking care of marketing, the second brother, elder brother was taking care of finance. So we were all managing and no formal meeting, nothing. And as the business started growing, conflict started growing. I think we withered away. Eventually we withered away. And having seen that, I felt that at least I should be cautious. Kind of very important thing as to how we kind of build the thing. I'm fortunate that in my business, I'm the first generation. Having been known various kind of things, I can design it well, but time is only will tell. Time will tell whether my decisions are right or wrong. And one of the important thing that I think, having seen the kind of problems, I've been, as my children growing up, we have been talking about meritocracy. There is no hierarchy. The eldest will not lead, need not be. I think it is meritocracy. And also talking about how important is business, and therefore family can be enjoying it for long, for generations to come. Therefore, don't take any interest which will harm the business. And that's very, very important. So they grow with that. And also very important thing is they don't naturally get a birth in the business unless they prove themselves. So it's meritocracy is a very, very clearly given. But if you look at every young generation, they have their own ambition. They want to prove. They think that they know many things, but they are not given an opportunity. So what I did is, to my three children, they'll be given capital, small capital. Very important, I would like to, within quotes, say small capital. Because no experience, I would like to push them in without any experience. And very important. And not with a lot of experience. They know what to kind of this thing and all, but jump in and start, learn by yourself. I feel that's much better. So my son, I gave a capital outlay of 10 lakhs, and he used it first for opening a shop of 7 lakhs. I think he proved it to be successful. First month he made money, second month, then he came back, "Dad, can you support me with another outlet?" I said, "Happily, I'll support you." So you prove, the capital will flow, kind of this thing. So second became third. I think now he has over 100 outlets in Chennai, kind of thing. And I'm very happy to see that he feels very proud. He earns it. He says, "Dad, do I need to come to Covincare?" So I said, "Not necessary. You just be a board member. So he is very happy and he would like to make something on his own. And he has found his own identity. And that I think is very important. So same is the case for my two daughters also. And the next younger daughter, she is going to start roll out a new version of a business. I think I'm sure that is June, July. She is going to July. She'll definitely be opening. All the kind of this thing, my eldest daughter has interest in education. She started her own play school, did reasonably well. Then, okay, now that kind of thing, there were not much of this thing. She has started handling our Kadalur education institutions. Now she is interested, okay, I'll continue to do. My passion is to do a lot of things for education. But I would like to do something in business. Because we are very clear that education is not a business. Education is this thing giving back to the society. So that way she said, I would also like to, because my son and daughters are, actually they are on the board of the company. They get exposure, very active discussions. And I being the kind of this thing used to handle now, I don't handle day-to-day business very actively. But how I used to be ripped apart by the board of directors, they have seen very closely and they are very nice. The most important thing is creating a very, very healthy board in the family business. It is not that I rule the roast, but the very independent directors fiercely kind of this thing, looking at which is good for the company, are we taking, how the business, whether we are living up to the commitment, what we project, all these things are very seriously taken. And I used to run the business, I am absolutely answerable. And some meetings are, my children, when we go back and ask, Dad, you are the owner, how they can rip you apart? So that's it. That's how you have to function. It's very important. There's no ego about who is the owner, which is right for the business. So we carefully selected, handpicked people who will come and voice out which is right for the business, than looking at, okay, is this going to comfort CKR? And that's it. That's not going to work for the business. I mean, that helps quite a lot in terms of that. The meritocracy helps, and they are growing. There is very active, healthy discussion at the family members. And we have a family forum. Every month we meet, and this month going to be on the 11th, we are going to meet. Very formally we meet, we go out, we have a boardroom kind of this thing, and there we meet, and there is a presentation by external members also. Sometimes they come and make a presentation. But internally also, I think, individually they make a presentation. And also I make a presentation about the company thing, whatever they go through in the board about what's happening, how we handle people. Because eventually I think the next generation, they need to learn about how they have to be emotionally stable if they want to be a successful business person. So emotional quotient, that and how you play with team members, people, and motivating them, and picking up the right leader, multiplying multiple leadership is another art. You can create one single kind of thing, but growing it to big is how do you multiply leadership? How do you identify? One way you can say, I will keep on recruiting from outside at a senior level and keep multiplying, but that brings in its own complexities of cultural distortion. And the best way to look at is, occasionally you do it, but most of the time, try to create your own pipeline of leadership. I think that's very, very important. So that, I think, sitting in the board, looking at whether the strategy is right, whether the structure of the people, the structure is right for the executing the strategy, whether you have the right people in the right place in the organization, and do you have the right processes. I think if you are very, very clear that I'm going to actively safeguard these things, that will go a long, long way. And this thing that we used to do is also every member of the family, they are getting inducted as to how they kind of this thing, because their signatories are very, very valuable. What they have to sign, what they have to look at when they are looking at, when you come to a board meeting, what you need to look at, what is business, how is business running, all these things are, they go through various stages of presentation. When they were, yes, very early in the 9th, 10th standard and all, I think they started slowly getting to understand how a business functions, what is people, all these kind of things. That helps. So my son was very anxious to run business. He said, do I need to complete my degree? I want to jump in and start business. So that's the kind of this thing, hunger in terms of when he was in college itself, he said, I'm going to start now itself. Parallelly, I will do evening business kind of this thing. So I think that hunger you need to create, you have to create an attitude. I think the parentage makes a huge responsibility if you want the kind of thing. And the next gen, every level, I think what we do, how do we cultivate the right attitude, giving and taking up, all these kind of things will go a long, long way. I think added to that, what Mr. KS was sharing about the family kind of this thing, what car you keep, if you want to kind of this thing, you need to understand those things and all, the equality of when you want to survive in an organization, that all will go a long, long way. I think that is a very, very important thing. So net, if you are wanting to make the family to survive, I think meritocracy is a very important thing. A good understanding, talk about various ambitions, feeling, all these things, a good family forum will go a long, long way. I think that what we discuss in the family forum will make it, while it is very formal and also deals with what is that, their concerns, their individual these things, aspirations, all these things we deal with that. If that is very effectively addressed outside the system, I think this will go a long, long way. I think with this, I close my speech. I think we have come to this thing next session to start at 11 o'clock. And being a past president of MMA, I'm very time conscious. Thank you very much. Thanks for coming here.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Ranganathan, for sharing your views and also being part of this inaugural session. May I now request President MMA, Mr. Ram Kumar, to kindly present mementos to Mr. C.K. Ranganathan and Mr. Srinivasan. Ladies and gentlemen, with this we come to the end of the inaugural session. We'll now have a short break and reassemble for the first session on shift in mindset of family-owned enterprises. Before that, may I request our group captain to propose a formal vote of thanks?
Because he decided no, enough is enough, let's go for tea. But it's my duty to thank the distinguished dignitaries who have taken all the time to be with us. Mr. Sikyar, it's always a pleasure to have you with us, and your words of wisdom are going to set the tone for the rest of the evening. Mr. Srinivasan, thanks. I know I keep troubling you most of the time. Every time you accept my invitation, it's always a pleasure to have you with us. Yes, I want to thank all of our partners, especially Vicky Flo, Deepali, and Accent Foundation, Archana, Tamil Chamber, and Sridhar. So many organizations, Rajesh, Agra Trade, who's sitting at the back. Many of them who have joined us and made this event great. Please join us for tea, and I can assure you it's a great one day. You're going to have the fantastic speakers around. Thank you so much for turning up in big number. Let's join us for tea. And meanwhile, now you can carry on with your briefing. Come.